The northern capital of the Russian Federation, St. Petersburg. In the late 1990s, the chekist, a name used to describe agents of Soviet secret police organizations, began his political career there. In a few years, this man will ascend to the highest office in the country. His relationship with the security agency helps him to create an unprecedented state syndicate, a strong union in which a bureaucratic hierarchy and the business elite siphon billions from the state budget, while security forces protect criminals and spy on the people. And the people have come to revere this governance of lawlessness in exchange for chameleon-like slogans of greatness.
Where does Russia's border end?
Russia's borders end at the Bering Strait with the United States.
Russia's border doesn't end anywhere.
He considers himself to be a grand architect by resurrecting the Tsarist myth of the great and mighty Russia. Using propaganda, he subjects Russians to hardship so they can rise from their knees.
We have to make a difficult but necessary decision. I ask you to be understanding.
For the past 20 years, Russians have been unable to rise from their knees. Vladimir Putin has no problem mobilizing all of Russia's resources for a single purpose – to blackmail the world with nuclear weapons.
Yes, it will mean a global catastrophe for mankind and for the entire world. But as a citizen of Russia and the head of Russian state, I would ask, what is such a world for if there was no Russia?
Nuclear weapons aren't the only levers he has to influence global affairs. He commands an army of lobbyists around the world, whom the Tsar opulently showers with cash. At 44 years old, the former deputy mayor of St. Petersburg moved to Moscow in August 1996. He began working for President Yeltsin's administration.
Yeltsin instructed Putin to collect all the data on the foreign assets of the USSR. On the basis of this, Putin got in touch with the richest and most influential people in Russia.
The former KGB agent basically continued doing what he once did for St. Petersburg Mayor Anatoly Sobchak when he led the Committee for External Relations for the mayor's office. This allowed him to weave his own web and create a criminal syndicate. He created the St. Petersburg Property and Capital Management Company, known as SPAG. One of SPAG's founders was a financier from Liechtenstein, Rudolf Ritter, who specialized in laundering cocaine money for the drug lord Pablo Escobar. The St. Petersburg mayor's office was represented in SPAG by Putin. SPAG affiliates in Russia included companies run by Putin's business partner Vladimir Smirnov and Vladimir Kumarin, the leader of the Tambov Mafia.
SPAG had the closest ties to Vladimir Smirnov. Vladimir Smirnov became, so to speak, the link between the Tambov Mafia, Vladimir Putin, and the SPAG in Germany.
Gradually, Putin found more work in Moscow for his colleagues from Sobchak's team. They include obedient future Premier Dmitry Medvedev, his close advisor Igor Sechin, Gazprom CEO Alexei Miller, former CEO of Sberbank Herman Greff, and Vitaly Mutko, the future Minister of Sport. Eventually, Putin's men gained control over all of the financial flows in the country.
Bloodletting, as well as the influx of the new blood, is always a healthy process, and it's doubly beneficial when the blood is healthy.
Back in the 1990s, it became obvious from Putin's first interviews what kind of government power he preferred.
I will not hide, and it seems to me that if we keep order with a firm hand, we will live easier, more comfortably, and safer. In fact, this comfort will pass very quickly, because this firm hand will start stifling us extremely hard.
In Moscow, Putin rose quickly through the ranks. For 2 years, he headed the Federal Security Service, the FSB. In 1999, he became Secretary of the Security Council of the Russian Federation. Then he was appointed Prime Minister.
Putin, in my eyes, is the product of the KGB, who works with criminal groups when he needs to. He built his authority by using the KGB's large archive and its information for blackmail.
In the late 1990s, Russian President Yeltsin's health rapidly deteriorated. He was living on pills and controlled virtually nothing. In these conditions, his main task was to choose a successor who could guarantee him immunity from prosecution. It was not only immunity for Yeltsin's family estate, but also for the assets of the oligarchs who supported him. The former KGB agent had the dirt on everyone and was a convenient candidate, although not for everybody.
When talk turned to Putin's presidency, I was totally opposed to it. I wasn't the only opponent. All of my friends had harbored doubts about electing a man from the KGB, the bloodiest security agency, as a president. I was in opposition.
An excuse was required to reduce these kinds of sentiments, and the more epic the excuse, the better. In 1996, a truce was signed in the city of Khasavyurt in Dagestan that ended the First Chechen War. It was widely considered to be Moscow's surrender and a slap in the face to those Russians who could not imagine losing the North Caucasus. The public desire for someone who'd be able to suppress the Chechens was noted by the special services. On the 9th of August, 1999, FSB Director Vladimir Putin was appointed Prime Minister of the Russian Federation. His first decision was to authorize a special operation against Chechen rebels. The operation was covered by all federal TV channels. Next, the world was shocked by a series of bomb explosions in apartment buildings, including apartment complexes in Moscow. Responsibility was swiftly pinned on Chechen terrorists when, in fact, they were the clumsy work of Russian special services.
3 days before the bombing of the apartment complex in Volgodonsk, Speaker of the State Duma Selezhnev made an announcement about the provocation for the explosion of an apartment complex in Volgodonsk. But the explosion had actually taken place in Moscow. A bombing did indeed happen in Volgodonsk 3 days later.
More than 300 people were victims of these terrorist attacks that bore the special services' fingerprints.
On the 22nd of September, the FSB tried to blow up a building in Ryazan. The search for the terrorists began, and just 1.5 days later, they were located. They were FSB operatives.
The resulting public outcry demanded punishment for the Chechen terrorists. The propaganda campaign opened the gate to Putin's first great war, whose purpose was to win him the elections.
We will pursue the terrorists everywhere. If they are in an airport, we will get them in an airport. And forgive me, if we catch them in the toilet, then we'll rub them out in the toilet. The question is closed once and for all.
Officially, the counterterrorism operation lasted until 2009. In practice, active hostilities involving bombings of residential areas continued for another year. Then Putin introduced the man who would be negotiating with the Chechen people. It was Ahmad Kadyrov, who, according to the rebels, was a recruited Russian agent.
When we busted into the FSB in Grozny, we found documents with the surname Kadyrov and the code name Adam on the cover.
The TV channels extolled the virtues of the wartime prime minister, who could also refrain from drinking vodka.
We must not be weak, even for the shortest moment, because if we do, then these people will have died in vain. Therefore, I propose to put down this glass today. We will definitely drink for them, for sure, but let us drink afterward.
The image of the non-drinking man of action stood in contrast to that of an eccentric alcoholic president, who often became a laughingstock.
I am leaving. I did all I could. I have signed a decree placing the duties of the President of Russia on the head of government, Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin.
Putin won his first presidential election in March of that year. He gained nearly 53% of the vote and almost immediately began to consolidate power. The oligarchs, who had enjoyed considerable influence over Yeltsin, fell out of favor with Putin and were forcefully stripped of power. Khodorkovsky ended up in prison, and Berezovsky found himself in exile in Britain. Independent media outlets such as ORT and NTV passed into the president's hands. Along with the state channel Russia One, they formed the core of the pro-Putin propaganda machine. Parties were allowed to participate in elections to the Duma, the Russian parliament, only with the president's consent. the way forward for the pro-presidential party, United Russia, was cleared of obstacles. The pro-government party gained exclusive powers throughout the Federation. Thus, the legislative branch was remodeled to resemble Stalin's Soviet Union, a dictator's treasured dream.
We ought to have fought for the integrity of the country, the Russian state. The Bolsheviks renamed Russia to the Soviet Union, but it still was Russia. They just lowered the flag and let this great state cease to exist.
That same year, laws were passed prohibiting concealing information deemed to be important to the state, as well as inciting protests. The number of crimes punishable by minimum 14-year prison sentences grew 1.5 times. The KGB successor secret service, the FSB, was given powers to demand access to any digital information and personal data of internet users from Russian internet service providers.
There are many people who support Putin. I'll explain why. Life is getting better, but nastier.
The approval rating of Russia's top spy exceeded 80%. The former KGB agent and all of Russia enjoyed a further windfall with skyrocketing international energy prices during the early 2000s. A golden shower of oil and gas dollars rained upon Russia. Control over financial flows gave Putin even more room to maneuver.
I just need to smile in some places to show that the devil is not so black as he is painted, or knit my brows to show that it is not allowed.
It seems like an innocent joke for the right audience, but it contains the key to Russia's modern political system.
Important step. Identify these kleptocrats and look, Russia is a gas station masquerading as a country.
Early in his presidency, Putin defined the so-called equidistance rule. That is, businesses will be allowed to grow if they remain loyal to the government and stay away from politics. In this, businesses will be helped by the upper class, the caste comprised of people from the intelligence agencies. Under Putin, one out of every three officials in the highest and middle levels of government came from the security agencies.
They are traveling on business in strategic leading Russian corporations concerning oil. They are coming on the board of directors and get non-good terms.
Theft in Russia with Putin's blessing becomes a national trait. After 18 years of his rule, the wealth that Putin's family and his inner circle have in foreign accounts is sky high. According to one estimate, he has more than $20 billion.
A recent report stated that there is $24 billion of unexplained income in Putin's inner circle. All of these benefits are not in Russia, where they have, of course, beautiful houses, cottages, and beautiful cars, but the bulk of the money is abroad.
According to another source, Vladimir Putin is the richest person in the world.
Vladimir Putin likes money. He likes it because he has. And he has a lot. I estimate that his wealth is $200 billion.
Of course, Putin doesn't flaunt his wealth. Putin's real net worth is almost impossible to prove. But other people's wallets provide a clue. For example, his nephew, Mikhail Shalomov, a mid-level employee at Sovkomflot, has $500 million in his account. Another old friend from St. Petersburg, the talented cellist Sergei Roldugin, passed $2 billion through his offshore accounts. Russians are brainwashed by explanations that this is necessary due to a sagging economy and a hostile world, but they are not shown the Kremlin chief's more than 20 lavish residences. Putin's grip on power would not be as strong. The regime's serious critics were gradually eliminated. Journalist Anna Politkovskaya investigated the corrupt schemes and profits Putin's entourage made in the Chechen War. She was killed on the 7th of October, 2006, Putin's birthday. The people who financed the killing have still not been found. On the 23rd of November of that same year, former Russian intelligence officer Alexander Litvinenko died in a British clinic. His poisoning by polonium is linked not only to his disclosure of Russian government secrets, but also to the threat he posed to the Tsar's reputation.
He is Putin's personal enemy. He accused Putin not only of theft, but also of homosexual pedophilia.
His killer, Andrei Lugovoy, became a member of Russia's parliament soon after the murder. Another critic of Putin's regime.
He monopolized everything, put everything under personal control. They become billionaires. He's afraid that the money might be out of hand.
Boris Nemtsov was demonstratively killed near the Kremlin on the 25th of February 2015. Putin's police state uses the tactic of controlled chaos, that criticism is allowed to be expressed by a single voice from a single source. Alexei Navalny does not deny that he is drawing a warm bath for Russia's dictator.
We will bring to justice all of your colleagues and pals that plundered the state with you. And if you will observe the law and ensure peaceful handover of the power, you can depend upon the immunity.
Because of its weakness, the Russian opposition is known as terry cloth. Putin has created a system of government that has brought Russian society under complete control by brainwashing and propaganda. The special services keep watch over the purity of information. You can even be thrown in prison for posting comments on the internet. The country has a de facto one-party system. Power is concentrated around the pro-presidential United Russia Party with its network of local branches and youth organizations. In particular, an organization called Nashi, meaning ours, trains young adepts of Putinism. Putin travels regularly to Seliger Lake to meet with Nashi. In time, Putin supporters spawned new, seemingly apolitical movements, such as Stop Kham or Lev Protiv. The former combats parking violations, and the latter fights drinking in public. Credit for this caught-on-camera justice is shared by the police, who do not arrest their activists but stand by their side. Meanwhile, Russian society is down on its knees. More than half of the Russian population live below the poverty line. 10% of its citizens control 89% of the country's wealth. So it turns out that the greatness of Russia is placed in the pockets of several hundred people. And to maintain the status quo, they regularly show any dissenters who is boss.
Если бы у бабушки, знаете, были внешние половые органы дедушки, мужчина, она была бы дедушка, а не бабушка.
He has many more jokes in his arsenal, together with cunning and outright lies, to feed to the citizens of Russia and the whole world, in order to intimidate or impress as required. But the more he tries, the more he becomes a laughingstock. But that's another story. Vladimir Putin has already broken the personal record held by one of his Soviet predecessors. Leonid Brezhnev was the head of state for 18 years. The record holder is Stalin, who governed for 31 years. It looks like the current chief resident of the Kremlin wants to break that record too, for experience in the system of government in Russia shows that for Putin, elections are just a formality. Present-day Russia simply doesn't have any strong enough arguments to replace its president with essentially another Tsar.